African American history for us today. The meaning of African American history for us today. And I would like to begin this presentation with a passage from the book of Deuteronomy, the fifth book of the Torah. The Torah is the first five books of the Hebrew Bible. For Christians, it's called the Old Testament. So from the fifth book of the Torah, or the Old Testament, the sixth chapter, Moses, who is the central human figure in Deuteronomy, admonishes the people who will become Israel. They're not Israel yet. Israel doesn't happen until Israel has its first king, Saul. And that is centuries from the time that we see this taking place in Deuteronomy 6. But Moses admonishes the people group who will become the Israelites. This in Deuteronomy 6 chapter. He says to them, these, in the 6th chapter, the 20th verse, Moses says, in the future, and what he's doing, he's taking them through Hebrew History Week. You know, like Black History Month. This is Hebrew History Week. Because he's telling them about their history. Verse 20 of chapter 6. In the future, when your children ask you, what is the meaning of the stipulations, decrees, and laws the Lord our God has commanded you, tell them, we were slaves of Pharaoh in Egypt, but the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. Before our eyes, the Lord sent signs and wonders, great and terrible, on Egypt and Pharaoh and his whole household. But he brought us out from there to bring us in and give us the land that he promised an oath to our ancestors. The Lord commanded us to obey all these decrees and to fear the Lord our God so that we might always prosper and be kept alive, as is the case today. And if we are careful to obey all this law before the Lord our God, as he has commanded us, that will be our righteousness. People of African descent who were brought here to the Americas. Americas would be North America. It would include the Caribbean. It would include South America. That would be the Americas. Africans who were brought to the Americas began to understand that there was a very close relationship between the experience of the enslaved Hebrew people and themselves. And ever since then, people of African descent within the Americas have associated their experience with these ancient people, people of Israel. Israel's history, as we just saw here, is a sacred history rather than a profane or common or ordinary history. The people witnessed and experienced God's presence in history. Their history, the history of the Exodus, of God bringing them out of Egyptian captivity miraculously, their experience in the desolate wilderness, their experience of receiving the law on Mount Sinai. In Deuteronomy, the elders were responsible for sharing Israel's sacred history with the younger generation. Israel is commanded to restate, reinterpret, and reaffirm its faith for itself and for future generations. Now, how have African Americans appropriated that sacred story in the biblical text for themselves? Historian, the late historian Vincent Harding famous African-American historian, passed away a couple of years ago, in his 1981 book entitled There Is a River, The Story of Black Progress in America, put it like this. He asked the question, why did it happen? Why did it happen? Why were we chosen to be chosen if we were? How in the midst of such death and suffering could we find so much strength to love, so much determination to live, fight on and be free? In permanent and grueling exile, how could a people dance and create songs and art, fashion institutions of hope, bear so many children of beauty in the land of our captivity, subject to a host of attempts at dehumanization and humiliation? How and why did we become this nation's foremost champions of human freedom and social justice? And what now is our future and this nation's destiny? If those costly, creative black visions of hope should be broken and bastardized or meanly forgotten in a ruthless and unprincipled process of Americanization. Wow, that's a mouthful, is it not? Is it not? I think we have some seats here. History. We're not talking about a history, but not just any old common history. The African-American presence in America has been an experience of our spiritual strivings, to use the language of W.E.B. Du Bois in his classic book on the beginnings of our history here in Black America. Du Bois uses this term, spiritual strivings. Our spiritual strivings provided us as African Americans with identity, purpose, direction, and discipline. It provided African Americans with the inner strength to make it, even though the doors of opportunity were closed. We knew somehow, in spite of it all, that we've come this far by faith, trusting in the Lord. Understand what we're talking about here. We're talking about not just profane history, profane not meaning profane as in saying bad words, but profane as in common, ordinary, workaday. No, African American history is embedded within a sacred history, closely associated with that of biblical Israel. No matter how bad things have been, no matter how bad things are, no matter how bad things get, there was the belief that God was going to see us through. The Lord will make a way somehow. As the Apostle Paul said of Abraham, African Americans against all hope, in hope, believed that God would bring about a better day, a new tomorrow, and a beloved community. Their faith was placed in what Paul called the God who gives life to the dead and calls things that are not as though they were. Romans 4:17. In the midst of incredible pain, anguish, and anxiety, our foreparents could still sing the old Negro spiritual, "You can't make me doubt him. You can't make me doubt him. You can't make me doubt him. You can't make me doubt him in my soul. You can't make me doubt him. I know too much about him. You can't make me doubt him in my heart." Understand what's taking place within the African-American psyche. that in the midst of the belly of the beast. And that is what America was. It was the belly of the beast. In the midst of the belly of the beast, African Americans placed their sense of somebodiness not within American political rhetoric. I'm referring to the Declaration of Independence. Why? Because the Declaration of Independence, especially as Thomas Jefferson had conceived it, we claim these rights as God's rights. And what are those rights? The right of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Well, Jefferson actually took that from John Locke, who was an English philosopher, who 80 years prior to Jefferson's statement, John Locke also spoke of the same thing. The pursuit of happiness was changed, I should say Jefferson changed Locke's language to the pursuit of happiness. It originally was the pursuit of property. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of property. Well, guess who was property? People of African descent. We were property. Now, Jefferson changed it to the pursuit of happiness, which meant the same thing, because people of African descent were actually slaves. We're going to get to that in a second. But African Americans situated their sense of somebodiness not in American political rhetoric, neither in the rhetoric of Christian America, because neither American political rhetoric nor the rhetoric of its Christian institutions valued black life. Let me say that again. Neither American political institutions, Declaration of Independence, Constitution, three-quarters of a human being, nor American Christian rhetoric, neither of these took seriously the value of these children of Africa. And so therefore, these Africans situated their sense of somebodiness within God himself. As one set of people asked me, well, why is it that young blacks are pronouncing this mantra, Black Lives Matter? We don't quite understand that rhetoric, Black Lives Matter. And I said to them, well, perhaps they're using that rhetoric, Black Lives Matter, because black lives have never mattered since the advent of this country. Black lives have never mattered since the birth of this country. Dr. King, in his very last book, Chaos or Community of Puerto Rico from Here, has a beautiful chapter on white backlash. Very serious chapter. And King, who was somewhat of a moderate, at least he's views that today, understood white racism as a congenital deformity in the birth of America. You hear that? A congenital deformity. In other words, America was born with a birth defect. This didn't just happen. That is how America was birthed. And African Americans understood that their sense of somebodiness had to be within the very fabric of the biblical narrative. You are somebody because you are made in the image of God. Irrespective of what Thomas Jefferson said in Jefferson's very last book called Notes on Virginia. Before he died, Jefferson wrote a book called Notes on Virginia, where Jefferson says in no uncertain terms that people of African descent are physically and intellectually inferior to whites. In fact, David Walker, the black Christian activist of 1829, took Jefferson to task for undermining the very humanity of African Americans. And where does Walker situate that? Within the biblical narrative itself. That you are somebody because God said you were somebody. Irrespective of what Jefferson said, irrespective of what the white American church was saying, You are somebody because God has said that you are somebody. But today, we are in the process of losing or forgetting this black sacred story.
That's right.
This black sacred story. We're in the process of losing or forgetting that story. A whole new generation of African Americans are emerging who know little, if anything, about the Supreme Court ban on school desegregation, the Montgomery bus boycott, student sit-ins of the 1960s, early 60s, the March on Washington in 63, the Voting Rights Act of 1965. We have forgotten black epic-making events. A whole new generation of African Americans are emerging, for whom the names of Medgar Evers, Fannie Lou Hamer, W.E.B. Du Bois, Carter G. Woodson bear little, if any, resemblance. In essence, we have a whole new generation of black Americans who are ignorant of God's actions in our struggle for freedom. Consequently, many of us suffer from a form of cultural and spiritual amnesia. We have forgotten the God of our salvation, and consequently, we have forgotten who we are as a people. Understand this, that when Daniel and the other Hebrews were brought into exile, the Babylonian captivity, the reason why they were able to keep their special identity as Hebrews is because they never forgot whose they were. The God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and them. Daniel never forgot that. A black Methodist minister in Harlem once said, "For the first time in black history, we are seeing an unchurched generation of young black people growing up in urban areas. In previous generations, you could always assume some knowledge of black church culture, like favorite hymns or prayers or some rituals. Today, there are teenagers out there in the streets who have no knowledge of and no respect for the black church and its traditions." Before coming here to Jackson in 95, I was teaching again at a Christian college in Memphis, Tennessee. One particular class was racially mixed, half white, half black, and I was curious as to test this theory. So I asked my class, I said, again, half black, half white, I asked them, well, we're going to come up with a song here, and I want to know how many of you know this song. Again, half black, half white, right? And so I said, all right, I'm going to start right out. Start off. I heard the Lord and he heard my cry. Oh, he heard my cry. And all the blacks began to chime in. My white students looked at them as if, I said, do you all go to the same church? Do you all know the same song? Where is it in the hymnal? It isn't found in the hymnal. It's an old African-American post-slavery chant. I heard it's called Dr. Watts' hymn. They can't find it in the hymn book. It was a song that was known amongst African-American church ancestors. Interesting, though, the younger African-Americans were as much in the dark as my white students were. We have forgotten who we are because we have forgotten whose we are. And because of that, today, we have, as a community, slipped into a state that philosopher Cornel West once called African-American nihilism. That word nihilism is a big term. It means many things. It has philosophical overtones. But at its core, nihilism is a spirit of emptiness and hopelessness. History under nihilism is understood as meaningless. there is a monumental eclipse of hope, an unprecedented collapse of meaning, an incredible disregard for human life. Let me get back to that. A incredible disregard for human life. Not only do black lives not matter for most white Americans, either consciously or not, black lives don't matter for black folk themselves. How do we know that? Take a look around you in the hood. I didn't call it a neighborhood. I called it a hood. There's a difference between a neighborhood and a hood. Two different things. So that it is possible for me to actually not only rob you, but to blow you away without a twinkling of a conscience. Because your life doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. Black lives matter? Well, I guess black lives matter except for babies who are in the womb. I guess their lives don't matter at all. When African-American women make up the largest demographic of abortions as a demographic group in America, as crazy as that sounds, that is the situation. African-American women make up the largest demographic of those having abortions. So I guess black lives matter unless you happen to be in the womb. So all of us have bitten into this fruit, so to speak, the spirit of nihilism, meaninglessness, hopelessness. Lerone Bennett Jr., exactly 40 years ago, Lerone Bennett Jr., the editor of Ebony Magazine, that many of you used to read, put it like this exactly 40 years ago, and he called it a crisis of the black spirit. Listen to what Bennett said. "We have come to a great fork in the road of black destiny. We have come by a strange and circular route to a place of danger and decision, which requires a mobilization of all the resources and energies of the black community. The danger is real and pressing. For the first time in our history, the inner fortresses of the black spirit are giving away. For the first time in our history, we are threatened on the level of the spirit, on the level of our most precious possession, on the level of the soul. And what that means is that we are threatened today in this country as we have never been threatened before. A great black depression and policies of malign neglect are eroding the social foundations of our communities. And the fallout from this is eroding the moral and spiritual foundations of black culture. The signs of crisis are everywhere. The homicide rate in the black community has reached such an astronomical rate that young black males are rapidly becoming an endangered species. And this alarming development is only an extreme manifestation of the anger, frustration, and purposelessness of hundreds of thousands of black youth who have given up hope and see no reason for accepting the discipline required for academic achievement and excellence. To come right out with it, we are losing an entire generation of people. And this fact, which is cultural, political, economic, and spiritual at the same time, constitutes the gravest challenge we have faced in this country since the end of legal slavery." That is remarkable. 40 years ago. It sounds like it came out of today's Clarion Ledger, doesn't it?
Bennett, round it up.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Bennett was not, hold up. That's right. Bennett was not a preacher. He wasn't a theologian. He might not have even been a Christian. But he understood, he had the spiritual sensibilities to know that something on a spiritual tip was taking place within the American soul. That is where we, and that was 40 years ago. That was 40 years ago. What is the meaning today in terms of hope? In terms of hope, the hope that we have. The hope that we have today is a hope that is founded within the biblical story. To rediscover the meaning of our history suggests that we rediscover the God that gives that history meaning. This is not God in a generic sense, you know, a God, a kind of a nameless God for everyone. No, this is the God, this God that our people have encountered is the God reflected in Jesus Christ. It isn't a generic God. It is the God that God has revealed God's self in Jesus Christ. Our experience of divine healing, mending, repairing, and transformation has meaning and significance for this world, what Abraham Lincoln once called a new birth of freedom. A new birth of freedom. A new birth of freedom. And James Weldon Johnson, great African-American poet, encapsulates this hope in that song that we sing every February, Lift Every Voice and Sing. Listen to that verse that says, sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Well, how long do we continue to march on? How long? For our ancestors' sake, brought here in slave ships, we march on. For Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, John Brown, and Sojourner Truth, we march on. For Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, and Marcus Garvey, we march on. For Fannie Lou Hamer, Emmett Till, and Medgar Evers, we march on. For those valiant white brothers and sisters who gave the sacrifice of their very lives for the freedom movement, like Viola Lazua, James Reb, Goodman and Schwerner, we march on. For Martin Luther King Jr. and El Hajj Malik El Shabazz, also known as Malcolm X, we march on. For our parents, grandparents, children, grandchildren, for generations yet unborn, we march on. And how long do we march on? We march on. We march on. We march on, and then we march on. Thank you.